Prophet Elijah, despite not having his own book in the Old Testament, holds a special place in the church. We know that Elijah was one of two people in the Bible whose bodies were taken to heaven. Elijah also appeared at the Transfiguration. Through his prayers, Prophet Elijah was able to raise a child from death and was part of many other great signs. Today, we're going to explore a couple of aspects of Prophet Elijah's life. We read about Prophet Elijah in the two books of Kings, or 3 and 4 Kingdoms. To give you a bit of context, Prophet Elijah lived in the land of Israel, which was in the north after the split between the northern and southern kingdoms was made in the wake of King Solomon's death with the civil war. So at the time of Elijah, there were the 10 tribes of Israel ruling the north, and all of these kings were in disobedience to God's covenant, because they were all worshipping other gods, and there was a lot of immorality more generally, drunken behavior and murder and theft between and within the tribes. This is one of many reasons for the prophets, who were chosen and commanded by God, to steer people and ultimately to hold the kings who ruled and influenced the way of the people, to hold them accountable to their covenant with God, that is, to worship only the one God of Israel, the true and almighty one. We read in 1 Kings 16 that Ahab, the son of Omri, becomes the king of Israel, and that Ahab did evil before the Lord, more than all before him. This is quite a statement. What particular evil could this king do when there were such violent and shameless precedents? The passage says that it is because he took Jezebel as his wife, who was not an Israelite, and whose favorite god was Baal. Because of this, Ahab went and served Baal, the god of rain and storms. He set up an altar for him, and we read that he did many more provocations before God, and did more evil things than all the kings of Israel before him. So Elijah goes to Ahab and says that, standing before the Lord God, there will be no rain except at his word. And so there was a drought for 3.5 years, which caused a famine and poverty and starvation in the kingdom. This punishment particularly proved that Baal was powerless because, as the supposed god of rain, he could not provide rain for his worshippers. During this time, Elijah was instructed where to dwell and was fed by ravens, all through God's discernment. This is the typical depiction, which is quite a beautiful sight in the icon of Prophet Elijah, being tended to by a raven. So God would tell Elijah where to go during this drought to sustain himself, and one of these instructions was to go to a particular widow. Elijah goes to her. He finds her gathering firewood, and he asks her for some water, and she gets him water. Then he asks her for some bread. The widow tells him that she doesn't have any. She only has a handful of flour and a little oil, which is enough to make one last bread before they die. Because that's all they had, there was no prospect, as far as she could tell, of being able to feed herself and her son to survive. But Elijah says to her, "Take courage and do as you say, but make me a small cake first, a small loaf, we would say, and bring it to me. Afterward, make yourself some and for your son. For thus says the Lord, the jar of flour shall not be used up, and the oil shall not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on earth." So the woman, in the depth of poverty, with just a tiny amount of food, obeys, and from then on her flour and her oil never run out miraculously. She and her son had plenty to eat until the drought ended. Now, this widow is an extraordinary model of hospitality. St. John Chrysostom lauds her and actually says that this woman had greater hospitality than Abraham, who is famed for his generosity to the 3 strangers at his door. Why does St. John say that she is greater? Because Abraham gave richly, but he was rich. He had an entire herd to pick an animal from to feed his guests, but she only had a handful to offer. She had nothing to run to. What she had was so humble, it was next to nothing. She was so vulnerable. She professed to being on the verge of starvation, and she knew that her son was also vulnerable, and yet she still gave. This is incredible generosity. She was able to offer and give despite the irrationality of the situation, and without placing herself first. and she received a lot more than what she gave, though she gave all she could. Elijah became poor to make her rich, showing also how Christ became poor for the sake of many. So after 3 years, Elijah returns to Ahab and tells him that by worshipping Baal, he has brought all of this suffering on Israel, and it's time for things to change. Elijah tells Ahab to gather all the prophets of Baal and meet him on Mount Carmel. There were 450 of them, and Elijah was the only prophet of God in the kingdom at the time. So they've all gathered on the mountain, and Elijah says, "How long will you be undecided between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him, but if Baal, follow him." How was this going to be settled? He proposed that two bulls be provided. The prophets of Baal could choose one and prepare it on wood, but not light the fire beneath. Elijah would prepare the other and do the same. Then each would pray to their God, and the God who answers by fire, he is God. The people thought this was a great idea. So they ran around, prepared the bull and the wood, and called on Baal loudly from morning until noon. They were begging, "Hear us, O Baal, hear us." But there was no answer, and at noon Elijah said to them, "Maybe Baal is busy. Maybe he's sleeping and you need to wake him up." So the people cried even louder and prophesied until the evening when the sacrifice was due. Then Elijah told them to gather close so they could watch him. He built the altar and then told them to pour water on the wood, 4 pots worth and 3 times over. So you can imagine the scene. The wood was soaking wet. The trench around the altar was filled with water. It was dark. And Elijah prays, "O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, that this people may know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have turned their hearts back." Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the offering and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, "The Lord, he is God." And Elijah said to them, "Seize the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape." And they seized them and Elijah let them down and had them killed, as was the expected punishment of the time. When Ahab told his wife Jezebel about everything that happened, she was furious and she threatened Elijah, telling him that he will meet the same fate as the priests he killed. Now perhaps we would expect that Elijah had some more bold words for her in response. But Elijah grew fearful and fled. The Bible actually says he ran for his life. He went into hiding in Judah in the south, and he prayed there, and he was disheartened and tired, but God took care of him. I think this can be a lesson also. Sometimes in life, we need to choose our battles. Elijah had great boldness in addressing the king, his wife, and the crowd of over 400 people who were all against him. He admonished them for their indecisiveness and their disobedience. He mocked their powerless God. But when another trial befell him, which threatened his life, he ran so he could fight another day. There are many examples of great saints who fled and went into hiding, such as Saint Polycarp and Saint Athanasios, who fled from his see in Alexandria 5 times in his untiring fight against Arianism. And he was scorned for this. People thought he was a coward. Sometimes we might think that if we have been obedient and fighting the good fight, we deserve to be protected from temptation and persecution. This cannot be the case. We are constantly having to struggle, but we do need to discern how we struggle with each trial. There are times to stand and use bold words, and there are times to quietly pray and retreat. May we seek God's wisdom in our struggles, as Prophet Elijah did.